So in last class we have started our discussion on this delay in combinational logic circuit, right? Because so far till before yesterday's class we have discussed about primarily on single gates, focused on the single gate and that too this inverter, and we have also seen single gates like NAND gate, NOR gate, etc. However, for multiple gates, particularly if the multiple gates are connected in a chain like this we have considered for this inverter chains only so far, right? But in a practical circuit, as we have discussed, it cannot be only the in chain of inverters, but it can be a combination of this inverter as well as the other gates connected in this chain. So how should we approach in estimating the delay for this type of chain, and how should we find the delay, and how to minimize this delay, how to size these different gates so that the delay will be minimized. So here we have started with our what we know that TP equal to from this expression, and the same expression can be simplified from like this. There's this total delay D is equal to this P plus F. P is the parasitic delay or intrinsic delay due to the parasitic caps, and F is the effort delay or the stage delay that depends on this fan out, right? As well as the complexity of the gate. Fan out, if you are considering only the chain of inverters, right? But if it is some other gates in between, then the complexity of this gate is also we need to take care of, because different gates has different type of delay as compared to if not different values of delay as compared to that of this inverter, right? So we have also seen how to estimate this how what okay I have also seen this one, that this F can be written as this G into H, where this F is the physically the fan out or electrical effort. Sorry, this F is this effort delay. This effort delay is equal to G into H, where this G is the logical effort and this H is the fan out or this electrical effort, right? And the fan out we can, or this H we can, or the electrical effort can be simply estimated from this output load by output load capacitance by the input load capacitance, right? Regarding this logical effort, we have also discussed quite a lot in estimating what will be the logical effort for different gates compared to that of an inverter. And in this context, we have also mentioned that if in a particular technology node, PMOS and NMOS ratio is 2:1 with ratio, then depending on that, we have a logical effort of 4/3 for this two input NAND gate. But if this in different technology, if it's not 2:1 but 3:1, then in that case, we need to consider these ratios accordingly and make this transistor widths for these different gates. And then we should estimate what would be the logical effort for that NAND gate or NOR gate or maybe any other gate, right? So we have seen that this for two input for this two input NOR gate, it was NOR gate, the logical effort was 5/3, and in general for NOR gate of n input can be given as logical effort can be given as 2n+1/3, whereas for this NAND gate in general, if the for n input NAND gate, it will be n+2/3, right? Then regarding the estimation of parasitic delay, we have also seen the parasitic delay we are estimating in terms of this the delay of an inverter, right? From that point of view, the parasitic delay of an inverter is 1, whereas the parasitic delay of 2 input NAND gate would be 2, 3 input NAND gate it will be 3. And we have also seen how to estimate that. For that, we need to estimate what is the total output capacitance connected with the V output node, right? And divided by the capacitance associated with the output node of an inverter, right? So that will give the parasitic delay. And while estimating the parasitic delay, we have also mentioned that we are now ignoring the delay at this internal nodes, right? For example, here there will be a capacitance. We are not considering this. We are not considering here, we are not considering the internal capacitance here. So from this yesterday discussion, we have seen for inverter, if the parasitic delay is 1, then for 2 input, 3 input and 4 input NAND gate, it will be 2, 3 and 4 respectively. Same the values will also be taken by this NOT gate. Then we have also seen this normalized delay a plot versus this electrical effort plot, where we have seen that this is the parasitic delay, right? And this parasitic delay will be when this H is equal to zero, basically then when you have no load. So it will be due to the parasitic capacitance of this particular gate only. So we have tried to plot it for the inverter. We have seen, we know this equation. From this, we have to just substitute the values of G and this P, then you will get the equation of this. From this, we have also seen that for this two input NAND gate, it will be like this. So I hope if it you have been asked for to find or the plot in this same plot, if you need to also draw the characteristics of this two input NOR gate or three input NOR gate or two or three input NAND gate, I hope that you should be also able to do that. Right. Finally, we have end our discussion with this, with an example. Suppose in this example, we have this inverter whose size or the total capacitance is given as this 10. Then this inverter is driving and two input NOR gate whose size is X, means the capacitance for this input is X, and this Y. Then next it is driving and another two input NAND gate whose size is Y. That means the capacitance associated, and if you look from this terminal, then the capacitance is Y. Then this is driving another inverter, which is Z. And finally, that whole thing has been driving a capacitance of 20 unit. Right. So we have we were discussing yesterday that how to estimate the total delay, as well as what will be the criteria to find that when the delay will be minimum. Right. So to figure that out, we have seen that first let us write that what will be the logical effort for each and individual gate. So that we have written logical effort for this gate is 1, for this gate is 5/3, for this gate is 4/3, for this gate it is 1. Then we have also estimated what will be the value of this H1, right? And how we will find H1? H1 will be this output capacitance, that is this 10, that is this X, by the input capacitance is 10. So like that, you have to find H2, H3 and H4. Right. Then yesterday we are asked the how can you find the total delay. See that if you want to find the total delay here, these things has not been given to you, right? This X, Y and Z, this has not been given to you, right? So you don't know the sizes of this, and you know the total delay will be dependent on the size of this X, Y and Z. So until and unless you know the values of this X, Y, Z, how you will find the value of total delay? That was the question, right? So we will try to solve this today and see what is the total delay. Obviously that delay will be the minimum delay. We'll put the criteria and try to find it out, right? So here, yeah, so from here, if you consider from this path, you know, from this path to the total, this 20 unit capacitance path, right? Then let us first find what is the path logical effort. So this is the logical effort for individual gates, inverter, NOR gate, NAND gate, again, this inverter, right? So let us first find what is the path logical effort, right? So path logical effort is given by this capital G. And how to find this path logical effort? It will be the multiplication of all this logical effort of each and individual gates, right? So which is this pi of G, we are writing it like this. So it is 1 cross 5/3 cross 4/3 cross 1. So you can see it will be 20/9, right? Then we have also find what is the individual H, right? Or the electrical effort for each and individual these gates. But if you consider the total path from here till here, right, then we can write the path electrical effort, which is given by this H, can be written as, see, we are trying to find what is the path electrical effort. So when you're considering the path electrical effort, then we know what is the final capacitance we have to drive. That is the 20 unit capacitance and the input capacitance is this 10. So it will be C out, that is the output capacitance of this total path, by this C input capacitance of this path. So it will be this 20 by 10, so it is basically 2, right? And you can see from here, when you are coming from this source node to this terminal node, you don't have any branch. So what do I mean by branch? That we will see maybe in the next example. For example, you could have this NAND gate could have driving one more inverter, right? Could have, right? So in that case, you can see it is not only driving a single inverter, but there is a branch. This path is getting a branch here at this. So this thing is not there in this particular example. So as there is no branch in this example, so what we can write, the capital F, I think you remember what is this, small f is equal to G into H. This capital F, similarly, this is for the total complete path. This is equal to capital G into capital H. So capital G into capital H means it is this 20 by 9 into 2. So it is 40 by 9. Right? So what is this F? F is, F is the effort delay. This effort delay of the total path, right? From here till here. This is 40 by 9. Right? Now, if you say that these individual efforts were like F1, F2, F3, and F4, right? Then we have seen, you try to recall this case where we have drawn this part for the chain of inverter case. You remember that, and you can do the same way and try to find what will be the sizing of this inverter so that the delay is minimum. And you remember that for each of them, right, the sizing factor was the same, right? From here to here, if the sizing is like X, then from here to here, the sizing would be the same, right? So that means you have to scale these sizes uniformly. That means the effort, okay, in order to have the minimum delay, the effort of each and individual stages has to be equal, right? So if we consider, or let me write this. Path delay is minimum when each stage bears same effort, right? So that means F1 is equal to F. I think you can do it from the same expression, from using the same technique that we have used. You remember that we have to take n minus 1 if the total number of gates here n, right? Then you have to take n minus 1 partial derivative and make them equal to 0, right? And for each partial derivative, when you are making this, then you will find the effort of this gate will be equal to this gate. Then for the next derivative, you will find effort of this gate will be equal to this gate. For the next derivative, you will find effort of this gate will be equal to effort of this gate, right? So ultimately, you can say the effort of this will be equal to this, will be equal to this, will be equal to this. Same thing what we have done for the inverter chain, right? So from that point of view, you can say this F, all will be the F, effort for all individual gates. So the total effort of this path, we know it is capital F, right? But individual efforts are F into F into F into F. That is equal to this capital F, right? So from that, we can obviously say this F is basically this individual effort of each gate would be equal to F to the power 1 by 4, right? So if we know that, actually, if you want to find it in general, then it will be F to the power 1 by N if the total number of gates are N, right? F to the power 1 by N or nth root of that capital F. Total path effort delay, right? So we already know the value of this F, that is 40 by 9. So maybe we can find its value from here, right? So if we calculate it, it will come out to be 1.45, okay, of this. So now you know that what would be the each and what will be the effort of each and individual stages or individual gates, right? Now once you know this thing, then okay, if you think from this part that this total delay would be equal to this, the total sum of this parasitic delay, right? Sum of this parasitic delay plus sum of this F, right? Or sum of this effort delay, sum of this effort delay for each and individual stages. So from this point of view, right? Let us do that in the next page. So what we have to do, we have to sum up all the parasitic delay plus we have to find what is the summation of all this F, right? So here obviously you can find it from by adding these all four parasitic delays of each and individual gates plus here it is four stages are there, so it will be four, right? It will be four into this F. And F value we already know, it is 1.45. So in the next page, let us continue this thing. So the total delay D would be equal to the total parasitic delay plus N into F to the power 1 by N. You understand, right? For this case, it is F to the power 1 by 4 for this particular case. So what will be the total parasitic delay? Let us try to find it. So for this parasitic delay is P is, this is inverted, so parasitic delay is 1. This is a two input NOR gate, parasitic delay is 2. You remember the parasitic delay is only depends, it is same for this NAND gate or NOR gate, right? And it depends on the number of input. So here also it is 2, so parasitic delay is 2. Here the parasitic delay is 1. So it is 1 plus 2 plus 2 plus 1. So if we put the values here, 1 plus 2 plus 2 plus 1, right? Plus this n is 4, number of stages, and this f, okay, this f to the power 1 by n we have just now, this is basically the small f, and that value we have already estimated as 1.45. So if we do this sum of these two, then you will get 11.8 unit, right? So this would be the total delay of this particular circuit, and obviously this is not that only the total delay, but also we have applied here the condition of the minimum, when the delay would be minimum. So the delay that we are getting, which is 11.8 unit, that would be the minimum delay for this path, right? Now it's not over yet, because our goal is to not the find the delay, but also find how we should we size the transistor of each and individual gate. That means how should we size the transistor of this inverter, this NOR gate, this NAND gate, again this inverter, right? To do that, what we have to do, see this, let us do it step by step. So this H, okay, that means each and we have already defined this H, right? Is the output capacitance by the input capacitance of each and individual gate, right? So from this, what we can write this H? H is basically equal to C out by C in, right? Okay. Then what is F? F we know F is equal to GH, right? Okay. So then if we have to find what is C in, right? Then C in can be written as this C out by H, right? Okay. Now if you substitute the value of H from here, then you can write it as C out into G by this F, right? Just from here, right? Just substitute the value of H. Why we are doing so that that will be clear to you right now. See here, to find any input capacitance, okay, we should know the output capacitance, we should know the logical, the this effort, we should know the logical effort. At the same time, we should know what is the value of this small f. Small f value we already know, and we also know what is the value of g or logical effort for of each and individual gate, right? Now let us see how can we use these expressions to find the size of each and individual gate. First you have to find what is the total input capacitance of each and individual gate. That means we have to find what is the value of x, y and z. Once we know the value of x, y and z, we can then find what would be the values of the widths of the transistor for each and individual gate. So if you now look, let us go to the previous this diagram. If you see this diagram now, we have to find the value of x, we have to find the value of y, we have to find the value of z first. And what is this z, what is this y and what is this x? These are nothing but the capacitance if you look from here, right? So basically it is the input capacitance that we have to find. So where to start with? Should we first try to find x or try to find first y or z? See, if you want to first find this x, then you should know what is the output capacitance here. The output capacitance is nothing but y, but till now we don't know what is the value of y. But if we try to first find the focus on this, we know what is the value of this output capacitance, which is 20 for this case, right? So we know the C out, we know what is the value of G, which is 1. We know what is the value of F that we have already found, 1.45. So here everything is known, right? So we can find what is the value of C in, and C in is nothing but the value of Z. So we can find the value of Z from here, that the Z is equal to the output capacitance it is driving, that is 20 into G. G is 1 for the last inverter, then by F, 1.45. So it is comes out to be 13.79. So this gives the value of Z. So what is Z? Z is the input capacitance of this inverter, right? And now you know this Z. So this Z is been driven by this NAND gate. So for this NAND gate, now you know what is the output capacitance, C out, right? So using the same formula, you can now estimate what would be the value of Y. So now we can estimate the value of Y from, this would be the output capacitance here, 13.79 into G, NAND gate, two input NAND gate, the value of logical effort is 4/3 by F, 1.45. So if you calculate it, you will get this 12.68. Then we have to find what is the value of X. Same thing we have to use, but when you find this X, this will be the X is for the two input NOR gate. For this two input NOR gate, the output value is this, because this X is driving this Y. So it is 12.68 into the logical effort of two input NOR gate is 5/3 by 1.45. So if you calculate it, it will come as 14.57. So now you see the unknowns, that is, or the size, or in other way, if when you say that size, you should remember it is the size. A size means it is the in terms of the input capacitances, right? So now we know the values of X, Y and Z, but still now we don't know what should be the values of the transistor widths of this PMOS for each and individual gate. Okay, one more thing here, to cross check whether we have done it correct or not, let us also try to find what should be the, using the same criteria, what should be the value of Cin for the first inverter. Even though it is given as 10, but let us verify it. So this inverter is driving this two input NOR gate, right? So that means it is driving this X. So if we find this for the first inverter, for the first inverter, it is basically the size, okay, this size would be, it is driving basically this one, 14.57, right, into G, inverter G is 1 by the value of F. F is 1.45, right? So you see that it is also, such size is coming to be 10, right, from this So you can see that even at the starting point itself, it was given that the size of this inverter was given as 10, right? We have used the same technique just to back calculate it and check whether these values are coming correctly or not, right? So now we have cross-checked as well. Now we have to focus what should be the values of transistor widths for this, this, and this. Even if you want it for this, that is also fine. Right, transistor sizes we need to find. Okay, so let us start from this Z. Okay, then we'll come from this right side to this left side. Anyway, you can come from this way as well. It's not hard and fast rule, but let us start with this. Okay, for this example, so let us start with this Z. Okay, Z means the inverter in stage 4. So inverter in stage 4. Now we are finding transistor sizing. Inverter in stage 4. Right. So you see that the starting point, we have mentioned that our inverter has a two unit of PMOS and one unit width of this NMOS. So the input capacitances will also be proportional to the widths, right? So that way you can say, like, if the input capacitance is here, this Cin of this inverter, then this Cin among the Cin two times, Cin of 2/3 is due to this PMOS, right? And for this NMOS, it would be Cin into 1/3 part. And you know that this, this capacitances are proportional to width, right? So we can also comment from here what should be the width of this transistors from here, right? So for this inverter, then stage four, we know what is the total size. Total size inverter, that is Z, is 13.79, right? So it is PMOS width is 13.79 into 2/3. That would be the width of this PMOS. This NMOS width would be 13.79 into 1/3. So this part is done. So you can now design what would be the width of this PMOS and what would be the width of this NMOS, right? So then let us think about the previous gate, which was the NAND gate, NAND 2 gate at stage 3, right? So if you now consider this two input NAND gate, if you recall from yesterday's discussion, so two input NAND gate is like this, right? Like this. So if you consider this is A, then this is also A, right? And if you remember the widths, here it is 2, here it is 2, here it is 2, here it is 2, right? The widths of the transistor. So you can say this for here, the ratio of PMOS and NMOS with in terms of these capacitances are divided is to 2 is to 2, that means 1 is to 1, right? That means half of the capacitance is coming from this PMOS and half of the capacitance is coming from this NMOS. So from here, you can easily calculate the PMOS width would be the size. Size means this was Z, then this would be the other previous one. So that means this is basically Y. So it is 12.68, right? 12.68 into half. And here this NMOS width would be 12.68 into half. Right. So now let us see the previous gate. So previous gate is this second, stage 2, and which is a two input NOR gate. So considering that two input NOR gate, so you remember two input NOR gate, right? Two input NOR gate is two PMOS are like this, right? And two NMOS are like this, right? And if you just now suppose this is A and this is A, So if you consider the total width here, then it should be like, you know, 4 and 4, and it should be 1 and 1, right? So here you can see the PMOS and NMOS, the capacitance will be divided as is 4:1 way, right? So the width will be also divided into 4:1, that in that fashion. So for this NOR 2, when two input NOR gate, which is a stage basically 2, then here PMOS width would be the size, which is 15.57. So you can see here, this is X 14.57. So this 14.57 into 4/5, right? Because you can see the PMOS is taking 4 unit out of this total 5 unit. And this NMOS width would be this 14.57 of 1/5, 1/5, right? Then further, if you want to find what is the size of this stage 1, that is, again, it is an inverter, then you know the size, which is 10. So it will be 10 into 2/3 of this PMOS, and 10 into 1/3 would be the size of this NMOS. So using this analysis, we can find what would be the transistor sizing as well for this type of chains of gates, where not only the inverter is involved, but also the other gates are also involved at the same time. So I hope this is not difficult. This is easy only. So if this part is clear to you, then let us now consider that the case, you know, we have just we have here mentioned, but we have not considered it in this particular example, that if what would happen if suppose if you have a branching here, right? So that means suppose if you have an additional inverter, okay, in parallel to this, but the path is this only, right? You have to charge this 20 and you have to consider the delay in this path only. But in this line, in this path, you have one more tapping, and you have tapped one more inverter from this output of this output of this two input NAND gate, right? So how to incorporate the effect of this? So this is here we need to consider one effect that is called this path branching. So let us take a simple example. Suppose this is an inverter whose size is 5, and remember, size 5 means it is the input capacitance is 5 here, right? And it is driving two inverters of size 15 and here 15, right? And each of this inverter is driving a capacitance of 90, right? So you can see here, if you were okay, and it is also mentioned that we are now focused on this path, means we are focused on what will be the minimum delay in this, you know, to charge this 90, this capacitance of 90 unit, right? We are, so the concerned path is this one, but from this path we have one more tapping of this inverter, and this inverter is also driving another capacitance of 90 unit, right? So how to find okay for this type of case, right? So here let us try to find it, try to find the total, total this effort, that is, let us say that the effort is here, this F1, okay, and here this effort is this F2, right? then let us find what is f1 and what is f1 and what is f2, right? And then what is the total f? So total f is basically f1 into f2, total effort. So what is the value of this PowerPoint has just crashed. Just a minute. Yeah, fortunately it is saved. Okay. Now let me share it again. Yeah, can you see the screen that can you see the this screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Just a minute, give me some time. This PowerPoint used to get crashed in between. Okay. So see here. Then what is the total F? Total effort. Total effort is this F1 into F2. So how to find this F1? F1 is for this, right? So here, and how to find this F? It is G1 H1. What about this F2? G2 H2, right? So you know this is inverter. So this logical effort or G would be 1. And what is H? H is the output capacitance by input capacitance. So for this case, that is for the first inverter, the output capacitance is 15 plus 15, right? Because it is driving this 15 as well as this 15. So it is 15 plus 15 output capacitance by input capacitance is 5, right? Okay. So what will be the G2? That is again for the this inverter, it would be 1. What is H2? This inverter is driving a capacitance 90. So it is 90 by it is 15, right? So that gives the total capacitance that, I mean, if you just calculate this, so you can see this become 30, it becomes 6, and this also 15, 9, 6. So it is 36, right? So the total value of AF, if you calculate it from this point, so the total value is 36, right? Now let us see that how have we just a minute, huh? Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So, sir, here the number is the transistor width, right, inside the inverter.
Sorry, Anish, could you please repeat your question?
Sir, what does the number inside the inverter signify?
Okay, this is basically the size of the inverter, is not the size of the transistor. It indicates the input capacitance of the inverter.
Like the input capacitance is directly proportional, that's why it indicates that, right?
Yeah, input capacitance, but if I say this input capacitance for this inverter, then it is easy to say the transistor sizing from here. But you think from here, you know, for this NAND gate, NOR gate, it has for only one input, for only one gate, right? You understand my point?
Yes.
Right. So here, if you say from here, so it is only the capacitance associated. If you look from this line only, it's not the total capacitance of this inverter gate. It's only the total capacitance associated with that particular input. Okay. Suppose the inputs are A and B. So it is the capacitance associated with that input only.
Yes, sir. Understood.
Okay. So far. In the previous example, we have seen that we have written this F, right? The same F equal to G into, in the previous example, we have seen, right? G into H, capital G into capital A. How have we defined capital G? Capital G we have defined, right? This pi of G, that means that all the G we have to multiply. And how have you defined this H? This path, the total path effort. Path effort is this 90 by 5, right? It is 90 by the total output capacitance by the input capacitance. That's how we have defined. Okay. Then what is this pi of G? It is basically 1 into 1, so it is 1, right? But if you now calculate it, it comes out to be how much it is coming? 18, right? So you see that here. If you estimate it like that, this individually, you are getting the value of F is equal to 36. But if you use the formula that we have used in the last example, that is F equal to GH, then it comes out to be only 18, right? And these two are not matching, right? So that means something is wrong here, right? We have not probably considered each and everything in these expressions. So what have we missed? The thing we have missed in this, we have not considered the effect of branching in these expressions. So to include that, we have to, this expression has to be modified, and we have to probably introduce one additional term. That term is called the branching effort, right? So how do you then define the branching effort? Okay. So branching effort again can be defined for each and individual gate. Branching effort can be defined for the total path as well. So let us first consider each and individual gate. Suppose for this there is no branching, so the branching effort is branching effort does not exist here. But what about this? Here the branching effort does exist, right? So for this, the branching effort does exist because it is not driving only one single gate, but is driving two gates, right? Whether the path is concerned is this, but in addition to that, we have tapped another gate from this path. Now, how to estimate that branching effort? Branching effort is given with the small b, that is we are considering for a single this gate, right? And it is given as the C one path plus C off path by C on path. Okay, so what does it mean? C on path, that means when you are considering this path, so here on path, in this path, the it is becoming two parts, so the 15 is there in the path, so it is 15, right, plus this off path. So in this path you are not considering here, but it is also driving this, right? So it is another 15 by this on path, so it is 15, right? So here this branching effort is 2, right? So here we can see the branching does exist only here, right? Means only for one gate, right? But you might have a situation where suppose maybe in the next example I will show you that you could have one more branching, right? Then in that case you should also consider the branching of this inverter, right? So then you have then multiple branching efforts, right? Like B1, B2, B3, right? And if you consider then the total path, then the path branching effort would be given by it is given as this capital B would be equal to this pi of B, right? So that means we need to multiply the branching effort of each and individual stages, right? So okay, in this context, let me ask you, what would be the branching effort small b for this inverter?
Sir, one,
exactly, because you see that it is you know, on path, it is, you know, for this one path is 90, right? Off path is 0, by again on path is 90, so it is 90 by 90, so become 1. So if there is no branching, then the effort is 1 there. So right, so whenever you have branching, then only that will be getting multiplied, right? So now we have introduced one more term here. See, here everything is this AF equal to GH, everything is in terms of the total path, right? It is the path logical effort. It is also to denote this H for this total path, right? And this B is also for the total path only, right? So this formula, okay, or this expression has to be now corrected and to this AF equal to GBH. So this is valid. Okay, this is like an for common expressions for any of this type of you know, digital digital device, means integrated circuits consisting of many gates. Because if you do not have branching, then you will get the value of 1. But you can also use this expression. This is conditional. This will be conditionally true for this expression. First expression will be conditionally true if you don't have any branching. In the last example, we have seen here, we don't have any branching. So that's why we have used this, and that was giving us the correct result. But if there was any branching, then we should introduce the term this B or the path branching effort as well. So let us see one quick example. So that would then this concept would be much more clear to you. Same. This is example 2. Suppose we have two input NAND gate. Okay, the size I am writing it inside, it is this 8. This input is A, and this is driving this 3 input NAND gate, right? 3 input NAND gate of size X. Now you understand what do you mean by this size, right? But not only one inverter, right? But suppose it is driving of same size 3 inverters. Sorry, not inverter, 3 NAND, 3 input NAND gates. Huh? Right. So this 3 input NAND gate is this driving. Fine. Okay. And each have the same, this same type of same sizing. Huh? Now, this output of this is driving one NOR gate of size Y. This is also 2 input NOR gate. But here also, we have one more branching. It is also driving another 2 input NOR gate, right? This NOR gate, both these 2 input NOR gates is also driving the similar 2 capacitors having a magnitude of 45 units. Right, and the path that we are concerned is this. Okay, this is the path that we are concerned. Right, now the question is, we have to find the minimum delay in the path, in this path. First question is this, we have to find the minimum delay in this path. That is number one. Next one is transistor sizes. Find the transistor sizes to estimate the delay. We have to also find the transistor sizes, right, for this each and individual gates, right? Then how to go ahead with that? Can you give me any idea? Because the first one, I think you should be able to tell me right now, because similar thing we have done. I have also mentioned like what change we must do here if you have any branching. Anyone? Okay, so see, let us write, you know, first the values of this in logical effort. That would be easier for us, right? So logical effort for this is this, you know, 4/3. Logical effort for this 3 input NAND gate is 5/3. Logical effort for this 2 input NOR gate is 5/3, and this two path is, this two is like 45 45, right? Then if we know what is the total values of the if we know the total in each and individual this values of logical effort, then we can also find what is the path logical effort, right? Path logical effort, this capital G, which will be 4/3 5/3 5/3, right? So it is 20 25, it is 100/27, right? 100/27. So then we can also find what is the total H, the path electrical effort, because we know the output capacitance, we know the input capacitance. Path electrical effort, capital H, is equal to the output capacitance, that is 45, by the input capacitance here, this is 8. So it is 45/8. Then we can also find what is the path branching effort, B, that we have just now learned. Path branching effort, path branching effort, here is one branching effort, that is B1 into B2, right? Now, can you please give me the value of B1 and B2? What would be the value of B1 and B2? Okay, what would be the value of B1?
3.
Okay, can you please explain why? Yeah, 3 is correct, but why? Can you please explain?
Sir, because on is just C X and off is 2X.
Right.
Divided
so
by X.
So X plus 2X, right? By on, right?
By X.
By X, yes. Right. Fine. So that basically gives us this 3, right, for this B1. And similarly, we can apply the same thing for here if you want to. Otherwise, by seeing only, you can say here, right, it become 2. But as we are doing it for the first time, so I am writing it. So it is Y plus Y, Y. So it basically 3 into 2, 6. So the path branching effort is 6, right? Okay. Then what is the total path effort? Capital F, path effort is equal to GBH, right? Earlier we have seen it, we have used earlier example only G into H because there was no branching, but now we have a branching, so you have to use GBH. So what is the value of G? It is 100/27. Value of B, it is 6. Value of H, it is 45/8. Right? Okay. Can you please check and tell me what the value means? What is the value of this?
125.
Very good. So it is 125. So it is F, right? Capital F. So if this capital F is 125, what would be the value of small f? So small f is the f for each and every stages, right? And for to make the delay minimum, we know that effort has to be same for each and individual stages. So what should be the value of this f, small f?
5.
Yes, right. So f is equal to 5, right? Then we now you see we know, okay, to find the total, to find the minimum delay, obviously this is the condition for minimum delay, this one is the condition for minimum delay, right? So from this we have find what is the value of this f, right? And if you know to find total delay d, we have to find that p means the summation of all these parasitic delays, right, plus the delay associated, okay, plus this n into f, right? So that's how we can find the delay. So we know what is the value of n. N is the number of stages, that is 3. This f is 5. We can find the parasitic delay for this. So if you want me to write it here, so we can write it. So this 2 input NAND gate delay is 2, then 3 input NOR gate, right? 3 input NOR gate delay would be 3 input NOR gate. What would be the delay?
3.
Okay. Then 2 input NOR gate delay would be 2.
2.
Right. So now you see the total unit coming is 7 into N. N is the total number is 3, number of stages. F is 5. Right. So this is basically the total delay. This is 22 unit, right? So this is the total delay, and obviously this is the minimum delay, right? This is the minimum delay. So we can easily find from here what should be the minimum delay, okay, for this type of combinational circuit, right? Okay, now let us go to the second question, the transistor sizing. Okay, now we need to find what will be the what will be the width of this each and individual transistor for this each and individual gates. Right. So again, to start with, you know that we need to start from here, because here C output we know, right? Then we can find the value of Y. Once we know the value of Y, then we can find the value of X, right? So we'll start with the 2 input NOR gate. So 2 input NOR gate, to find that this is Y. So Y is, let us go back, Y is our driving output capacitance of C45. You know the expression, if you forget the expression, maybe I can write it. It is C out, right? C out into that logical effort G by the value of F. So C out is 45 for the last gate, and its G is 5/3, right? 2 input NOR gate, and logical effort, this F is 5. So it's done. It is basically 15, right? So Y value is 15. Now Y has been driven by this X, right? So this 15 would be the C out for this into G. G is what? The logical effort for this 2 input. You see that this is, this is for the 3 input NAND gate, and logical effort is here also, it is 5/3, right? So it is 5/3 divided by F. F is also 5. So it is, comes out to be 5. Now the question is, am I right?
No, sir, we have to include branching, right?
15.
Yes. Very good. See here, in the previous case, we have considered that this Y has been driven by only X, but here X is driving this Y as well as this Y, right? So it will be this 2Y that we have to consider, right? So when we have to find this, it is not only this Y, not only the Y that we have to consider, not only 15, but it is 15 plus 15, right? 15 plus 15. right, into that G. What will be the value of G? 5/3 by F is 5, right? So it become 30, so it become 10. So the size, you know, it is for 15 for Y and 10 for this X, right? 10 for this 3 input. This is for 3 input, what? 3 input NAND gate, this is for 2 input NOR gate, right? Now the transistor sizing. So let us start with this 2 input NOR. So 2 input NOR gate. What is the ratio of width? PMOS, NMOS width?
4:1.
4:1, right? So then what would be the PMOS width? PMOS width is out of 15, it will be taking 4 out of 5, right? And what would be this NMOS width? It will be 15, 1/5, right? So, okay, let us do that. So it is 15, how much it is coming? 15, 3, 12, right? It is coming 12 and it is coming as 3, okay? So 12 and 3. So this is for 2 input NOR gate. So let us also find for this 3 input NAND gate. So for the 3 input NAND gate, what is the ratio of PMOS and NMOS width? Yeah, please tell me, what is the ratio of PMOS to NMOS width?
1:1. 1:1,
are you sure? Could you please recheck?
2:1.
Maybe, okay, why it should be like this? This is NAND gate, right? NAND gate means PMOS are parallel, right? This all 3 PMOS are parallel and NMOS are in series, right? NMOS are in series. So NMOS are in series, PMOS are in parallel, right? Okay, now you know, to make the width same of, or to make the resistance of the pull up and pull down network same as that of the unit inverter, then you can easily say like this width would be 2:2:2, right? Okay, what would be the width of this here? NMOS?
3.
Right, it should be the width of 3, right? Then what is the ratio? So if this is A, then this, say this is A, then what is the ratio of NMOS, PMOS and NMOS? PMOS and NMOS, what is the then ratio?
2:3.
Huh, then 2:3, right? So it is the 2:3, right? Then what would be the width of this PMOS width? So here the total is 10 out of 2/5, right? So it comes out to be 4. NMOS width is 3/5, comes out to be 6. Fine? Okay. Now, let us also find, you know, what to should, because we have been asked to find the total width for all. So, let us also find for this 2 input NAND gate. Huh? So, for 2 input NAND gate, 2 input NAND gate, what would be the width of this PMOS and NMOS that we have already done? I am not okay, but what will be the width for 2 input NAND gate, PMOS, NMOS?
Ratio 1:1.
Yeah, right. So basically then PMOS width would be then 4, right? Because it was 8, right? So it is 8.5, so it is 4. And NMOS width would be also 4. Right, so now we know the transistor sizing for each and individual transistor, right? So whatever has been asked to us, we have estimated almost all the things, right? But let us also, for our curiosity, let us do a simple exercise on that. Let us try to find what is the propagation delay of each and individual stages, right? This stage, this stage, this stage. Okay, find them individually, because now we know what is the value of x and y, and then add the individual delays, and let us see, and let us compare that value after addition, whether it is matches with this 22 unit that we have estimated using this formula, right, or not. Okay, so to start with, okay, what would be the delay for this two input NAND gate? So for this two input NAND gate, the delay would be the parasitic delay, right, plus this F, or we can write the, you know, this expression for this, that is D, or for all the gates we can write this D is equal to parasitic delay plus G into H, right? So let us do this exercise for each and individual gates and estimate the individual, the delays associated with these individual gates. So for the first delay associated with two input NAND gate. So now we are finding individual delays. So it is two input NAND gate. So for two input NAND gate, if we have to find the individual delay, then it is, we are writing this P1 and like P1, G1, H1 like this, right? So two input NAND gate. So what is the propagation delay for two, parasitic delay for two input NAND gate value?
Two,
right? What will be the value of G1?
4 by 3.
Very good. Very good. What would be the value of H?
3x by 8. So,
yeah. So, what is the value of? What is the value of x? 10. Okay. So, see from here, you are right. So, what would be the value of this H? So, for this output capacitance means x plus x plus x, right? By output capacitance, by the input capacitance. Input capacitance is 8. So it will be 10 plus 10 plus 10, which is basically 30 by 8. Right? So 10 plus 10 plus 10 by 8. Right? Could you please do it for me? How much it is coming? How much it is coming?
7.
7. Right. Okay. Then let us go to the next one. Let us say this three input NAND gate here. So three input NAND gate. Okay. Here, this D2, we are writing it as P2, G2, H2. So three input NAND propagation delay. I am saying it propagation. It should be the parasitic delay. Parasitic delay value 3. What would the value of G2?
5 by 3.
5 by 3. What would be the value of this H? Now for that we have to go here. What is the value of H? It is Y plus Y by X. Right? Y plus Y by X. So Y value is how much? 15. 15 plus 15 by H. Right? So basically it is 30, so it is 3, 3, 3, play gone. So it is 8. Right. Okay. Then what is the next stage? Next stage is for this two input NOR gate. So two input NOR gate. Let us say the delay is D3, and we are writing it in terms of this. So P3, parasitic delay. It is two input, so it is P is 2. What is G? It is 5 by 3. What is the value of H? Yeah, for that we can look into here. Yeah, but here only one capacitance, 45, right?
45
so by 45
y.
By Y. So 45 by Y. Y is 15. right? So it comes out to be 17, right? So see here, we have this here three stages, 1, 2, 3, right? And we have estimated the delays for each and individual stages, right? The first delay is 7 units, second stage delay is 8 units, third stage delay is 7 units. Then what would be the total delay? So total delay, you see, it is 22 unit. And whatever we have estimated using this path branching and F equal to GBH, from here we have find F and then find this 22 unit. So that is also, it is also this, see, this 22 unit, right? So this other way to do it, right? So whether we do it in this process or in this process, the results are coming to be least same only, right? So I hope with this discussion you have, I mean, you have got the basic idea about how to estimate the minimum delay for any combinational logic circuit along a particular path, right? And what do you mean by logical effort and this type of stuffs, right? So in this regard, we have now primarily focused on three gates. One is this, primarily three gates. One is the inverter, second one is the NAND gate, third one is the NOR gate, right? But there are other gates as well, for example, XOR, right? So what will happen if you have, suppose here, one XOR gate? What will happen if you have, suppose, one XOR gate, right? How to estimate this logical effort for this XOR gate, okay? And do some, and suppose if you have some XOR gate here, XOR gate here, XOR gate here, then how the analysis will change? I think that I will request you to please look into that. Like if you have any other gate other than these three basic gates, then how this G we need to calculate, logical effort have to calculate it, how the propagation delay will change in that case, and how the total analysis would be the same way, the process would be the same, but I request you to please go through the cases when you have X or other gates, for example, XOR gate in between. Okay, so yeah, any question? Okay, so if there is,
Sir, in all these cases, we had been given the value something like 8 for the first inverter, right? Which was the effective capacitor sizing.
Right,
input capacity, right. Sir, but what happens if they don't give it and they tell us to do it with an actual value of capacitance, input capacitance?
With the actual value, what do you mean by actual? But if you
it's,
do not know,
the final capacitor is 45 farad, means something like 45 picofarads.
You are trying to say, like, suppose if the values are given, like suppose 3.3 picofarad, then what you will do, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so in that case, one more information will be given to you that for per unit width, this is the capacitance.
Okay, sir.
You understand my point? So that the other information would be given to you so that you can find what would be the width of this. Right. Or if it is, suppose, the some practical data from some, you know, practical data, then you have the data sheet of that company, right? Or the manufacturing fab, that for our this process, for per unit width, we have a capacitance of this value, right? So from that point of view also, if you some value is given, like some particular magnitude is given, you should be able to translate it then what is the width, right?
Yes, sir. Got it, sir.
Okay. So if there is no other question, then